Presenting Dr. Gurunath Parale, a product of prestigious Institute PGI Chandigarh, a pioneering cardiologist with more than 25,000 invasive and 1 lakh non-invasive cardiac procedure. Excellent academician, teacher and speaker at various conferences with more than 40 national and international publications. Outstanding clinician and recipient of many fellowships and awards.
More of a clinical topic which every one of us comes across in ICU. And these are my real life patients, most of them are my real life patients and real ECGs which I have encountered, and we all encounter once in a while, and which help us manage the patients, sometimes change our strategy of managing the patients, and sometimes it really helps in treating or curing the patient. Basically, what I am dealing with is a non-ischemic. Ischemic ECG is very discussed quite often at every forum. So I will concentrate on the non-ischemic ECGs in ICU or a critical care setting. Now, these are the real-life patients. A 45-year-old man, he presented with acute onset dyspnea and chest tightness. Now, this was the ECG. In fact, the referring doctor suspected, rightly so, this could be an antroseptal infarct and was referred for further investigations. It looks a coving of STT changes in V1 to V3 could be antroseptal infarct. What was against is for a patient of this degree of infarct to become breathless. This degree of infarct will not give rise to a significant left ventricular dysfunction and patient presenting with breathlessness. Angina is expected, but not dyspnea. His chest is clear. So this is less likely to be heart failure because of infarct. So these are the things one has to keep thinking, that we might not be dealing with an ischemic setting. It might be something different. And you do echo, you find right heart pressures are high, and the diagnosis is obvious, is pulmonary embolism. So pulmonary embolism can mimic an antroseptal infarct. So a cardiologist, in fact, there have been examples where he has been rushed to the cath lab and you find coronaries are normal. So a pulmonary embolism has a variety of manifestations in ECG. One of them is entry infarct. Now this is a patient, I don't know whether you can see from a distance. If you can see, now this is a patient where this patient has manifested with ECG simulating an inferior infarct. So you can have an anterior infarct. This was again a Purwan pulmonary embolism and high pulmonary artery pressures. So it was an inferior infarct. So you can have an anterior ECG changes, septal ECG changes, inferior ECG changes. Sometimes you can have changes in both anterior as well as inferior leads. And you can again mistake it for ischemia. So always do an echo, see if there are high PA pressures, and if the PA pressures are high, then you come back and think, I may not be dealing with a case of an acute ischemic setting. It could be something else. Especially if the saturation is on lower side and the predominant complaint is dyspnea and not angina. This classical S1, Q3, T3 is discussed more often. You see it occasionally, but discussed more often. You see subtle T wave changes in V1 to V3, incomplete RBBB, tachycardia as more common signs than this more classically described S1, Q3, T3 pattern. So this is about pulmonary embolism. Now this was a 60-year-old porter, Hamal. He came with acute dyspnea. He had oligogram for a previous day, and this was his ECG. The diagnosis is obvious. He had hyperkalemia. Now he had a bradycardia, he has absent P waves. Now hyperkalemia is a very useful diagnosis to make on ECG, because if diagnosed, it responds immediately to the treatment. immediately responds to sodium bicarbonate, calcium, and it obviates pacing. So if you can diagnose hyperkalemia on ECG, before the lab reports are available, if you give that, and if you correct the potassium, the temporary pacing may be obviated. They respond so quickly to the treatment. So it is very important to diagnose hyperkalemia. Now, hyperkalemia has a slightly more correlation with the ECG changes, the degree of hyperkalemia. As the potassium levels build up, the ECG changes also slightly change. This is as against hypokalemia. So hyperkalemia, the degree of hyperkalemia has a better correlation with the EC changes. The first is a tall T wave. What is a tall T wave? A tall T wave is more than 10 millimeters in the precordial leads and more than 5 millimeters in the standard limb leads. That's a tall P wave. If the T wave is taller than the R wave in the same lead, it is a tall T wave. What is the characteristic of hyperkalemia on the T wave of the hyperkalemia? It has a narrow base. Unlike the tall T waves of acute infarction, this has a narrow base. So this is what it should make you suspect that this could be hyperkalemia. As the potassium levels increase, gradually the P wave amplitude goes down, and then what you have is atrial paralysis. So there is no P wave. So in hyperkalemia, you may have what is called as a sinoventricular conduction. This is as against atrial fibrillation. Here the atria just act as a conduit for the transmission of the impulse from the sinus node to AV node. So it just passes off without depolarizing that atrium. So there is an atrial paralysis. So what you can have is a sinoventricular conduction. And if the potassium levels are very high, more than 8, then you can have a wide QRS and absent P waves, bradycardia. That's a life-threatening situation. Now, this was a lady who came with the restlessness following an episode of gastroenteritis. Just a recent lady. And you have STT changes, the resident expectedly diagnosed this as a acute coronary syndrome. But if you see closely, there is a prominent U waves. And this was a case of hypokalemia. Just after correction of potassium, the ECG normalized. Now, hypokalemia can mimic ischemic heart disease, especially in a high-risk patient. If the patient comes with symptoms of coronary syndrome, then you can mistake it for acute ischemic episode. Now this has a little less correlation with the degree of hypokalemia. Only thing, the height of U wave goes on increasing. Now what is a prominent U wave? U waves are best seen in mid-precordial leads. If the height of U wave is more than the T wave in the same lead, then that's a prominent wave. It's not the only presence of the U wave. If the height of the U wave is more than the T wave in the same lead, then it is a prominent U wave. In severe hypokalemia, you can have a ST depression and a terminal positive deflection, which suggests it could be a U wave rather than the T wave. Now, this is in fact a newborn. This is the ECG of bradycardia newborn. What you see here, it's 2:1 AV block, 2:1 AV block, and a very marked prolongation of QT interval. Very marked prolongation of QT interval. Now this prolonged QT interval is of a peculiar type. You will see this QT, the QT segment is straight. The QT interval is not like this. QT interval is straight. This is very characteristic of hypocalcemia. So prolonged QT interval at the cost of ST segment is because of hypocalcemia. Unlike the prolonged QT interval of hypokalemias, myocarditis, ischemic heart disease, where the T wave also broadens. And this is what distinguishes. Just after the correction of calcium, the sinus rhythm was restored. So we have to it is a very good clinical clue to diagnose hypocalcemia on the ECG. Now this is what it is. So here it is, the QT is prolonged. QT segment is prolonged. If QT is prolonged, it is like this. Because T wave base broadens. Here it is, T wave is a normal amplitude and width, but the QT segment is prolonged. Now this is a patient. Naturally, what you see is a very tall peak T wave, narrow base, hyperkalemia. At the same time, if you see here, there is a QT prolongation at the cost of ST segment. So this is a patient of hypocalcemia and hyperkalemia. You can make a clinical diagnosis of this. Now, which condition does it have? A hypocalcemia and hyperkalemia. It is chronic renal failure. So you can diagnose a chronic renal failure based on ECG alone. So this is a very important, ECG can provide a very important clue for the clinical diagnosis in an individual patient. A 70-year-old lady of rheumatic heart disease. She was on digoxin and diuretics. She presented with repeated episodes of syncope. If you can see, there were multiple episodes of torsad, polymorphic VTs. So this patient of a rheumatic heart disease had multiple episodes of torsad, which obviously were the cause of syncope. Now she had the ECG, say this is not there, it's not seen here. She had very prominent U waves and a prolonged QT interval. So I knew she had hypokalemia. The question is, she continued to have syncope. Required multiple cardioversions. Her potassium came as very low, 1.5. Now, till the time the potassium required to be built up, it is going to take. You just can't hurry with the giving the potassium. You have to. You can give maximum of 20 milliequivalents per hour. You can't give more than that. Now, what should I do? She continued to have episodes of syncope. She continued to have these VT episodes. What should I do? I was just thinking, what should I do? Till the time the potassium levels normalize. I thought of whoever it is. It was like in late in the night. Should have taken around an hour or a day. Till that time, suddenly it struck me. And I started on isoprene. I thought, you know, I knew I should have decreased the duties. I thought, let's give a try. And gradually, her eyes were on also. The electrical students were carefully together to the system and I know the treatment. So we try for the opportunity. But this is, I have a very dramatic response to isoprene infusion. And she remained in isoprene until the time her, she became a child and until the time her profession was built up and subsequently she did not get it. Now this is the, I was taking the number of this patient was admitted with someone else and I was doing this ECG. I kept on thinking, there is something wrong with this ECG. What is this? I just kept on thinking, something, I have not seen this ECG for a long time. And suddenly it struck me. You have what is called as a Osborne waves. This is the ECG of hypothermia. I gave this ECG for the diagnostic to my teacher who taught me ECG, Zawar sir, and he immediately came up with the diagnosis of hypothermia. So this is a very rarely ECG. This patient had a massive cerebral infarct and that was the cause for hypothermia. The temperature was 93 degrees Fahrenheit. Unfortunately, he did not make it. So this is an ECG of hypothermia which we rarely encounter. Now this is again a case of hypothermia. You can see the Osborne waves, very subtle cases. But if you look for them, definitely you can pick up those hypothermias because we don't normally see the core temperature. If this is what makes you to measure the core temperature, and if you increase the temperature, the patient's general condition can improve. So these are subtle ECG clues can help you to manage the patients. A 56-year-old lady was operated for CA esophagus, again recently. Just before discharge, she had acute left ventricular failure and had to be put on ventilator. Her echocardiogram revealed akinesia of interventricular septum and LV apex. And bring down the lights, please. You can keep the lights down only. You say, what is that? This is an anterior infarct. So that was my diagnosis. This anterior infarct, echo is showing akinesia IVS, LV apex, LVF, elderly lady, ECG is anterior infarct. So what's great about it? Her enzymes came as normal. Her troponin T, CKMB came as normal. I thought I have done it too early. I repeated it after 12 hours, again came as normal. Then it struck me, this could be something else which is mimicking the infarct, but not an infarct. So what it could be? Gradually, as expected to my diagnosis, within 2-3 days, ECG started changing. She clinically improved. Third day, she was extubated. In 1 week time, her LV function normalized and her ECG normalized. So this is what is Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. So Takotsubo cardiomyopathy is a condition also called as ICU cardiomyopathy, also called as stress cardiomyopathy, also called as apical ballooning syndrome, which mimics atrial infarct. You can have a near normal enzymes or marginally elevated enzymes. Usually within few days to weeks, the LV function normalizes. I did her angiography. Angiography was normal, just to document that it was Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. And she is absolutely fine, off diuretics, everything now. And the LV function is totally normal. This is typically present in middle-aged females, preceded by a stress or sometimes infection or some disease. Now she has been operated for severe esophagus. I have not seen this. I have seen a couple of cases following a stress, but this was the first time I saw following some procedure. So this is not a very rare entity, but one has to look for it because it is passed off as an infarct. It is passed off as an infarct. So you have to look for this entity before labeling it as an infarct. A 60-year-old gentleman with carcinoma of prostate presented with increasing dyspnea. This was the ECG. What is it? This is a very classical electrical alternance. You will see the alternate QRS beat have a changing morphology. This is diagnostic of massive pericardial effusion. Because of a massive pericardial effusion, heart tends to swing inside the pericardial cavity. So during each beat, heart is at a different distance from the surface. As a result of which, the amplitude of the QRS changes with each beat. So there is a, and this is best appreciated in the precordial leads. So this is an electrical alternance which you can diagnose clinically. You don't need echo. A CA prostate patient, he had a malignant pericardial effusion subsequently tapped. So this is different from a pulses alternance, which is an alternating beat amplitude. This is an electrical alternance. The amplitude, the pulse remains regular of same amplitude, but the ECG amplitude changes. You have to differentiate between the electrical alternance and the pulses alternance. A 27-year-old lady presented with episodes of syncope. Her brother had a sudden death. And this was the ECG. Dr. Narasimhan might recall this patient because this is a patient of arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. You can see the epsilon wave there. He has put in a ICD device. The patient is fine. So this is an epsilon wave, and this was a patient diagnosed as ARVD. A 40-year-old pediatrician, Dr. Somani might recollect, had episodes of lightheadedness and near syncope. He came with the ECG. Now this was a junctional rhythm. He had a junctional rhythm, bradycardia, went to the physician. Physician noticed junctional rhythm, gave atropine, patient was fine. Pediatrician, he went home, rate was normal. In the evening came back, again had lightheadedness, bradycardia, and junctional rhythm, again atropine was given, patient went home. Now patient was worried. One episode he ignored. Second episode, he was worried whether he needs a pacemaker. So he came to me. I was just thinking that time for next subsequent 2-3 days, he was in sinus rhythm. On third or fourth day, he came to me. I was just wondering what it could be, whether he needs it, whether he needs pacemaker, what's it? Myocarditis, echo was normal, enzymes were normal, no prior history of any infection, upper respiratory tract infection, nothing. And suddenly it struck me. I asked him the history. When was it occurred? It had occurred on Monday morning. I asked him what he did do the evening prior. Specifically asked him, did he go to his farm? And he said, yes. After a long time, he had not gone to his farm. He had gone to his farm and handled the pesticides with his bare hands without using gloves. This was a cutaneous absorption of organic phosphorus poisoning. And naturally, it didn't need anything. So it was just and he got reassured. Yes, it was because of that. Otherwise, he was thinking of putting a pacemaker, and he's fine now. Now this is our own case, which Dr. Rudrakshi might recollect. This was another pesticide, Amtrax poisoning. You have STT changes initially, then it went on to become a very wide QRS, RBV pattern, ST elevation, AVR. This patient succumbed later. Now this, a 60-year-old lady, she had a short history of fever and followed by dyspnea. Now this was the ECG. He had a poor progression of R wave from V1 to V3. There were prominent U waves suggesting it was a hypokalemia. The echo showed there was a mild electrolyte dysfunction. There was hypokinesia of IVS. So it was an old entry infarct, hypokalemia. It's fine. What happened next was important. Immediately after, short while after this, this was the ECG. Can anyone make the diagnosis? Because once in lifetime you see such ECGs. You see the T waves. Alternately T wave morphology is changing. T wave. This is called as T wave alternance. This is a very ominous sign. This is a precursor of a very malignant arrhythmia. And as happened, she started developing significant VT, VF, VT, VFF. I required to give her multiple antiarrhythmics and overdrive pacing to control her. This is a, you can appreciate here, T wave alternance. See T wave alternance. Here, here. The T wave rhythm is regular, the T wave morphology is changing in alternate leads. And she developed episodes of this arrhythmias, but we could control it and discharge. Thank you.